altar built, a table spread, a tree that grew, a life was spared. Between two thorns, justice was placed, blood for the world, amazing grace. Oh, how I'm drawn to the cross alone, the place where mercy and sin atone, the place where my sins met therein. Everything changed there, the cross alone, new life begins there, the cross alone. A rugged piece of justice took a carpenter, a Christ that would give up his life in exchange for a world so lost, to claim his name. Sing. The cross alone,
the mercy,
and my sin atone. Met there in
everything
at the cross.
The cross alone,
new life begins
there. The cross alone.
There's a place in eternity where the love of God. It was the place,
where
all of my sins
met
therein. Because of Calvary, new life begins there. The cross, yes it did,
yes it did.
I know it, yes it did,
yes it
did. Now we want to sing a few hymns about the power of the cross, and I hope you help us sing it out there. Come on.
So I'll cherish
the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, I lay them down. I will cling to saved on. I need everybody, wherever you are, open your mouth and declare it.
Thank you. What's up, everybody? Good Sunday morning to you. My name is Bree, and I want to welcome you to Hope's House. You joined us on a very special day. It's the Takeover service, y'all. What's the Takeover service? That's when our youth and young adult ministries take over the whole entire service, top to bottom. You're in for a treat. Today, we've got the praise and worship team, Takeover style. We've got some special music from our buddy, Roman Collins. So right now, go ahead and hit that share button, like, and engage with us in the comment section. This is gonna be a great time, you guys. So go ahead, grab your wife, grab your husband, grab your kids. We taking over. Oh.
If anybody glad that Jesus didn't leave you where he found you, give him a praise. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. The old made new till I met you. You called my name
and I ran out of that grave.
Say, out of the darkness,
out of the darkness,
into your
glorious day. Freedom is all I know. Now your freedom is all I know.
The old made new.
The old made new.
Till I
met you.
You called my name.
You called my name.
And I
ran out of that grave.
Out of the darkness.
Out of the darkness.
To your,
into your glorious day.
Hey. You called my name.
Shelter. I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer. Your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open ever since the day you called my name.
Sacrifice, we are no longer the same. Isn't that good news?
Yeah.
Watch this. I am free. Praise the Lord, I'm free. No longer bound. No more chains holding me. My soul is rested. It's just a blessing. Hallelujah, I'm free.
Today is Friday, January 29th, 2021. Please turn on your cameras and unmute yourselves. Hello, good morning. Am I talking to myself? Turn on your cameras, unmute yourselves. Look alive. I don't see anyone yet. I don't see anyone yet. I guess this is minus. Ah, good morning.
Mom.
Oh, that's Mr. Hi, Mr. Johnson.
I'm not on mute.
Oh, sorry.
How you doing, Ms. Taylor? Look, in honor of Black History Month, which starts next week, I wanna give an ode to the historical Black church and the power of song. So I have a special guest for you guys. Please welcome Pastor Jones. Pastor Jones? Pastor Jones, we can't hear you. You gotta like unmute yourself. Yeah. It's at the bottom.
Right there, like, oh, can you hear me? Can you hear
yes,
me?
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Amen. Praise him. Praise his name. I'll mute myself. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Pastor Jones. Now, let me tell you a little bit about myself before we begin. I was born in Mississippi. And when I was a little older than what you all are right now, we marched and we sang. And we got jailed and we sang. Now, can anyone guess why song is so important to us? Oh, yes, you right there.
Well, my grandmama, while she be cleaning the dishes, she be singing old songs, but I don't understand why she be doing so much.
Oh, praise her. Well, why is music so important to you, young lady?
Well, it helps me get through bad days.
Oh, and that's exactly right, because that is what music did for us.
But why do you guys have to yell and stomp and then run around the whole church?
Nina.
Oh, no, it's okay. I believe that they should speak their mind. And I also believe, young lady, that you meant shout instead of stomp. Anybody get something that they really wanted for Christmas this year? All right, now imagine.
I got a PS5.
PS, that's one of them game consoles, right?
Yeah.
the little Atari with the stick. I know what you mean. I love one of them. I be getting all those. Well, imagine if you got an Atari or a PS5 or a Nintendo doohickey, and it's something that you really, really wanted. You probably run around the room and scream too, right? Well, that is what music helps us to express. Our gratitude for Jesus giving us the best gift, eternal life. And our gratefulness for how he shows us time and time again that he loves us. So that's why we sing, we scream, and we shout. And we even take a lap around the church. And if we didn't know what else to do, we would just say his name. Well, we don't do that in church anymore. If you can call on him like you want him to show up, he will. Say his name.
Jesus.
No. I need y'all to say it with your chest.
Jesus.
Oh, no. Come on. I know y'all can do it better than that. Now say it like you need them.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Praise the Lord, Hope's House. If you know that the God we serve is a great God, I dare you to put your hands together right here. Come on!
Be alright. Thank you, God. Amen. You know what? Sometimes you just got to take it back. But one thing about God is that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Before I get started, I would like to acknowledge our pastors. I am so glad they are feeling better. We love them and we honor them. You know what, Hope's House? How are we? I really miss y'all. It has almost been a year since some of us have seen each other in person. That is so crazy to think about. And what a year this has been. It feels like it's never ending. It's been traumatic, stressful. It looked nothing like we imagined. And we faced so many big losses. My biggest fear, my worst nightmare, what I feared would be the worst thing that could have ever happened to me, happened. It happened. This past October, I lost my dad after what was supposed to be a routine heart surgery, which I will share more on later. And honestly, it has not been easy. I miss my dad terribly, but God always meets me where I am. Whether it be through quiet whispers or sending a friend to speak the truth over me, I am consistently reminded that I am not alone. And I thank all of you for praying for my family and I. It has really gotten us through. So today we're going to be looking at Mark 12. If you can turn with me or look on the screen to Mark 12, 28 through 31. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another, them as in Jesus and the Sadducees, the religious rulers at this time. And seeing that he answered them well, the scribe asked him, "Which commandment is the most important of all?" Jesus answered, "The most important is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.'" God, we just thank you so much that we can gather today, even though it is virtual, God. I mean, things look a little bit different, but we can gather today and worship you, God, and hear from you, God. I pray that right now you just speak through me, God. Use me as your mouthpiece, God. May the words that I speak, may they come from you, from your heart, God, out of your love. We honor you today with this service. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Now, one thing I do know is that my dad is in heaven. He is in the presence of God, because as the Bible says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And you know, for the first time, I am really trying to imagine what heaven looks like, knowing that I know somebody that's up there. Heaven has been on my mind a lot, like a lot. And I've been on a quest to learn more about it. What is heaven like? What does it mean to truly be in the presence of God? And how do I make sure I get there? And so I read this book called Imagine Heaven by John Burke. It is about near-death experiences, stories of people who have almost died but experienced a taste of heaven instead and have come back to tell their story. You know, before reading this book, I wasn't really sure how I felt about near-death experiences. But to be honest, there are huge correlations with scripture. What I have come to believe is that God uses these near-death experiences to, one, paint a picture of heaven for us, to excite us for what he has prepared. Two, to supplement or add color to what we see in scripture. And three, that these stories should always lead us to desire Jesus, not just what he has created for us. You know, one of the first things mentioned in the book was the life review. What is the life review? So the people who have gone there describe it as this crazy experience. They're in the presence of this being of light, this beautiful, bright light, and all they feel is love. And this feeling that there is no hiding anything. For the first time ever, someone completely sees you for who you are and understands. Then this being of light asks you the question, "What have you done with the life I gave you?" Then it happens, just like a movie. Your whole life plays out in front of you, all the moments, all the things. When I first heard this, it scared me. I mean, I know Jesus sees and knows all, but having to watch it back with him, yeah, that seems like a lot. Woo! But you know, there are so many people who have never met who describe this exact same experience. You know, some rich people get up there and they start acting bougie. They're looking forward to the moment in the movie, which they feel like was the climax of their life. Where in the life review is me winning my Nobel Peace Prize? Where is the part where I close that huge deal? What about my first movie premiere? What about when my song went platinum? Where is it? Where's that moment? It's not there. Instead, what they described seeing was their lives played out in third person and actually being able to experience how the people they came in contact with felt and thought in response to their interaction with them. When they see this playback of their life, it is all about relationships. There was nothing about accomplishments, nothing about successes, all about how they loved other people. What they realize is that every little action has a relational reverberation, person to person, down through the generations. How you treat people, there is a reverb on that thing. How you treat people has a ripple effect. It's bigger than just that one moment. Can you imagine going down memory lane, all those interactions with your family and your coworkers, and instead of feeling the justification you felt in that moment, you're privy to experiencing how you made the other person feel? Wow. You see, because as John Burke says in the book, he says, everybody wants to change the world, but nobody wants to love their neighbor. It's the most simple of things. But we don't think it's important. But the most important commandments are not about changing the world. The most important commandments are about love. Because the truth is, how we change the world is through love. We've been in a series about making God's presence first. In order for us to understand how we make it to heaven, the ultimate place of his presence, we have to understand the role love plays and how we seek out his presence. We have to understand what it means to love God and love our neighbor. Could it be that that simple practice is the key to ushering God's presence here on earth? So, what does it look like to actually live out these commandments to love God and love our neighbor? Well, in order to love well, we have to experience being loved well. Jesus is the greatest human example we have of how to love people, but he also knew how to receive love. In scripture, we see him stealing away to ensure he spent time with God. It was there he would experience the love and the strength that he needed, where he would be refilled. You know, a lot of spiritual people would call this the mountaintop experience, shutting everything down in order to commune with the Heavenly Father. It's just like gas. You don't get gas in your car one time and expect it to run forever. You have to keep going back to the gas station to refill. The same is true for us spiritually. We all need to make a practice of having mountaintop experiences. They will help us love better. When you receive love from God, you're refilling your tank up. When it's full, you have more to give. So if Jesus needed to refill his tank and spend time with God, how much more do we need to? God's love is an absolute. There's no question about it. He loves us. God loves you. 1 John 4:19 says, we love him because he first loved us. It's a given. It's simple. It's unconditional. It's not based on what we do or what we don't do. He simply loves us. On our best day, on our worst day, we are loved by God. 1 John 4:8 says, anyone who does not love does not know God because God is love. So if God is love, that means the closer we get to God, the more love we experience. The more love we experience, we then learn how to share and model that for others. But it takes intentionality to experience more of his love. He will never force himself upon us. The more we lean in, the more we experience. It's just like any relationship. The closer you get to someone, the more you're able to experience them. And as you spend time with them, the more intimate your experiences become. And when you experience a love so remarkable, you, one, can't get enough of it, and two, you can't help but want other people to experience it. Think about your favorite restaurant. Just imagine it now. or your favorite food, your favorite dessert, taste it on your tongue. When something is so good, you post about it. You tell your friends. You can't help but want other people to experience the amazing food you just tasted. Well, the same way you introduce your friends to great food or great experiences, it's the same when it comes to introducing people to God. We are people's connection to those who do not know God. Some people may never seek out God for themselves, but we get to show them a glimpse of what it's like to be loved by Him. You know, sometimes as children, we don't understand the things our parents do. Sometimes we think they're doing too much. My dad woke up every morning at 4 a.m. He loved every single person he came in contact with. He was everyone's best friend. He made everyone feel at home and genuinely cared about how everyone was doing. Even the people that were written off by others, he would bring them in. Relationships were restored because he chose to love people despite what they did. He gave everyone a chance. His heart was always open to share love with people. No matter what they'd done, he never allowed judgment to get in the way of how he showed love to them. You could tell he knew he was loved. I believe in his early morning, 4 a.m. quiet time, he received what he needed from God to love like he did. Just like my dad overdid it when it came to loving people, God always overdoes it. He loves us so well that we can't miss it. And that's what it looks like to love other people, to overdo it, to go the extra mile. Have you ever met those people that you're like, they have to be saved? It's just something about them. They're so nice. They're just so kind. Every time I see them, they have to know God. Because our connection to Him, when others see, when we're connected to God and connected to Him, others should feel that connection when we connect with them. Do you have that kind of impact on people that they feel the love of God when they interact with you? Quarantine gave us so much time to make time for God. If we could not make time then, it's very unlikely that we will when the world opens up again. We can engage with God in ways that work for us. It's a relationship. You know, once I realized what it meant to be in relationship with God, it was so freeing for me. I can engage with God in ways that work for me. If it's while I go for a walk or while I'm journaling or walking through nature, just like I bring my personality in any other relationship, I can bring my full self to God even more so without judgment. It doesn't have to look like anyone else's relationship with God. If you're a planner, put it in your calendar to make intentional time to engage with God. If you're more spontaneous, find a random time in the day to hang out with God. However you do it, do it. You are not bound by a time, but you need to be consistent. Just like in any relationship that we're invested in, consistency matters. Showing up and intentionally spending time matters. What is important is that we engage with our best friend and take time for him to show us what it means to be loved deeply. Because it is out of that place of experiencing God's love that we find the energy, power, and strength to do what matters to him, love our neighbors. How we treat people matters to God. How we make them feel, it matters. Jesus spent a lot of his ministry rebuking the scribes and Pharisees. These were the religious people, the people who knew the law. Yet they were ostracizing others, excluding people. They were acting funny and being really mean. We see in Mark 2, 16 and 17, when the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him, Jesus, eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." They were cutting off groups of people from experiencing God because they did not fit a certain standard. They were too dirty, or because their sins were more visible than theirs. But Jesus didn't care what people did or what they looked like or who they were. He loved them. His mission was to love him. So my question to you is, who are you eating with? Are you spending your time with people who don't look like you? Are you spending your time with people you don't agree with? Who are you spending your time with? In December 2019, my dad had a stent put in after he had a heart attack. Within the first 10 months of 2020, he went to the emergency room 5 times, telling them something wasn't right, and had a series of phone calls and follow-up appointments. in which they would send him back home claiming it was acid reflux or heartburn. Eventually in October, he had another heart attack and they realized the stent they put in never actually worked. Now, quick side note, this says a lot about our healthcare industry, especially when it comes to people of color, but I want to encourage you to advocate for your health. If you know something is not right with your body, advocate for yourself, speak up. They don't always know. So when they realized the stent wasn't working, they decided to do a double bypass. Over the next 5 days, my dad was noticeably in a lot of pain. He was not eating and not really being able to walk around. And the day he was scheduled to come back home, his heart stopped. They tried to resuscitate him for an hour and 40 minutes, but he passed. The doctors were confused that this routine surgery did not work, so they ordered an autopsy. Upon receiving the autopsy, they found out that he actually had a sickle cell crisis. The doctor called us and said, if we would have known, we would not have done the surgery. If we would have known, we would have been less aggressive and more gentle in our care of him. If we would have known, we would have been less aggressive and more gentle in our care of him. Is it possible that our approach is why we're losing some people to the enemy? Could it be that as a body of believers, because we're not letting love lead, we have faced some unnecessary casualties? We have turned people away from God. We have ostracized people and made them feel as though they don't belong. Could it be possible that we would reach more people if we would allow the Holy Spirit to lead us? Our job is to love people enough to introduce them to the one that loved you and to let God do the rest of the work. We don't get to choose who is worthy or deserving of love. That is not our job. Please, let's not lose any more people to the enemy because of a lack of love. But how do we do this, right? How do we love the way that God loves us? How do we make his presence first in our interactions with him and with others? Well, a couple of things. One, we have to stop making excuses for why we don't want to love people. Loving people is not easy. That is true. But if we experience love, we receive the grace we need to be patient and kind to others. Two, we can't assume how other people feel. They honestly might be having a bad day and a simple smile might help loosen them up. Or they haven't had anyone ask them how they're doing. Yes, they did have an attitude, but they probably also have a really ugly situation at home that we can't even begin to comprehend. We can't take it personally. Again, we are not here to judge, but to love. Three, we have to deal with our past wounds and allow other people to love us as well. We can't be afraid to love and trust others because of what happened to us in the past. We have to let our walls down. And that doesn't mean we let everybody and their mama in. But we ask the Holy Spirit for wisdom, for who he wants to bring into our lives to love on us in this season. Jesus loved us beyond our sins and our flaws. That's what brought him to the cross. That's what brought him to rise on the third day. And Christ calls us to love beyond what we see, to love beyond what we think we know, to love beyond experiences. We are called to love beyond. You know, if we can't imagine heaven being better than this, we will be less intentional with how we live this life. If we think that this is the best we're going to get, the house, the car, the spouse, the job, traveling, whatever it is, we will live to get all of that and not live knowing that these things are just a glimpse of what God has prepared for us in heaven. Jesus said, "My Father's house has so many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you?" Do you really believe that God's level of creativity is limited to what we see on earth? That it doesn't get better than this? You know, sometimes I think we live as if it doesn't get better than this. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, no ear has heard, nor the heart of man imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. You know, before losing my dad, death scared me. And heaven seemed like it would be boring, to be honest, mostly because my brain cannot conceptualize what complete peace feels like. I mean, it doesn't seem like there'd be anything to do. What is a story without conflict? But I believe God has prepared a wonderful place for us that we can only imagine. Not only is it a place where we experience God face to face, it is a place of magnificent wonder. I want you to close your eyes. Close your eyes and imagine the most beautiful place you've ever seen. The weather is perfect, not too hot, not too cold. You see colors bouncing, colors you have never seen before. You're so captivated by them, you can spend forever just looking at them. In the background, there's music. It seems like everything is singing. The grass, the trees, the leaves, all in perfect harmony. Magnificent sounds you've never heard before. And you join in. You are in the perfect key. Your voice blends in effortlessly. There's no need to hurry or rush. You can stay in this moment as long as you like. You see a bright being that draws you in. Love radiates from his presence. He knows everything about you, but there's no shame or hiding. There's no desire in your heart to run away because for the first time, you feel so safe being who you truly are. A strong sense of belonging fills your heart. You want to stay here. You feel so seen, so loved. And he says, "Welcome home." Heaven is a real place. God is inviting us into eternity with him after this life. But what do we want? Treasures on earth or treasures in heaven? Do we want to be with Jesus? Do we truly trust that he is our greatest reward? But we have to keep the main thing the main thing. When we allow God to love us, we help others experience his love and his glory, which then compels them to want to know and experience them for themselves. John Burke said, "The world tells us money matters, power matters, prestige matters, and we drive ourselves crazy trying to prove to one another that we're successful enough, important enough, or powerful enough. Yet, in the end, it's relationship that truly matters. How ironic that in trying to prove we are worthy of love, we can miss accepting God's love and sharing it with those around us. And in the end, that matters most for true success. Everybody wants to change the world. Nobody wants to love their neighbor. But if we love the way he has called us to, and we make his presence first in our interaction with him and with others, then I believe the same greeting that my father received that October morning, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little, and I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of the Lord." I believe that same greeting we will hear. God, we thank you that you have prepared an amazing place for us. You have prepared a heavenly home, God, our real true home, God, we will truly be ourselves. God, a place where we can be with you throughout all eternity. And God, even though our minds cannot fully conceptualize that, God, I pray that you will show us, God, that you are so worth seeking after. God, I pray that we will strive to seek after your presence here on earth. God, I pray that we will strive to love you and love our neighbor. God, that we will be people that are so consumed with your love that we can't help but share it with those around us. God, I pray that we walk as loved people, as people who are loved by their Father. And God, that other people would come to know you as a result of the love that we experience. God, we thank you so much. God, we thank you so much that you were always within our reach, that you were always so close and that you always draw near to us. God, if there's a shift that we need to make in our hearts or in our minds, God, God, show us that. God, show us. God, show us the next steps to take in our relationship with you to go deeper, God. God, we want to see more of you. We want to experience more of you. We want to experience your presence and bring your presence here on earth. We want to see heaven on earth. So show us what that looks like in our individual lives, what we have to chip away, what we have to throw away, what we have to get rid of, God, so that we can experience more of you and bring more of you here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, what an awesome reminder of the big picture, the ultimate goal. Thank you, Tease, for that word and for sharing your heart story. Some of you all may have heard all this talk today about heaven, and it's piqued your interest. You want to know, what does it take to really get there? How do I make sure that I can be in that beautiful place? I want you to call the number on the bottom of the screen. You're not going to get an automated message, but real prayer workers there to talk with you and walk you through it. If you've heard today's service and today's message and you want to rededicate your life, hit that line. It doesn't matter how old you are. There's no shame in that. We're excited to be able to connect with you. Just because we're not in person doesn't mean that we can't have that experience with you. So please, please don't be afraid to call that line. We would love to get in touch with you. If you're looking for a church home, you're looking to join the church, also call that line. Just because the doors of the church are closed doesn't mean that they're closed. Our pastors would love to welcome you in. If there's ever been a time that you need to be covered, I believe this is the season that you need to have a covering. So go ahead and make sure to get connected with Hope's House on all our social media. And we'd love to walk that out with you. As always, during the takeover services, we're going to leave you with some practical tips. This week, it's really simple. Love God and love your neighbor. Tish, she walked that out so well in her message. Love God and love your neighbor. So here's some ways that we can practically live that out this week. Number one is to reconnect with the Father. Get in your word. Read God's love letter to you. I promise you, he is worth the seek. So our challenge is one chapter a day. Read God's love letter to you. And then number two is look for moments throughout your day to love on people, whether that be big or small. Find a way to love on somebody every single day this week. I want to thank you all again for joining us for our takeover service. We love you so much. God bless you.
Hey, Hope's House family.
Y'all know what time it is.
It's time for offering.
You know the Lord loves a cheerful giver, so go on ahead and reach in your pockets. Find whatever money you got. What kind of Bitcoin?
Whatever, $2 bill.
Whatever it is that you got. And go ahead and you can submit it through the app or online. We miss you guys. We love you guys. We hope that you all are doing well.
Staying safe.
In this panoramic.
Perpendicular.
You know? We hope to see you guys very soon, and back to you guys. Bye.
Good morning, Hope's House. Thank you for watching with us this week, and here are our weekly announcements. Don't forget about our midweek conversation this Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Tune in to hear the heart of our pastors regarding Sunday service and more. Next Sunday is Vision Day. Join us as our pastors cast the vision for the new year. Remember, Hope's House is here for you, God loves you, and we are Hope's House Strong.
Hi family, thank you so much for tuning into service today. We know we can't meet in person just yet, but make sure you follow us on all of our socials and look out for emails for updates on when that will be happening soon.
Also, we just wanted to say thank you for, you know, caring about us as our family was sick and had COVID. We just want you to know that we appreciate everyone who called, checked in on us, and just stopped by and even brought us food, but we feel the love and we want to say thank you.
Love you guys. See you next Sunday.